summit, and I'm excited to learn and to share with everybody. So I'm going to start my timer. I've been told to go with what's on my heart. I've been talking to some people here, and so what I had prepared, I'm going to do something a little bit differently. And hope that it's what somebody needed. At the age of 19, I was a happy, successful, confident college student at a top 20 university. And by my 21st birthday, I was a depressed, suicidal, lost, confused college dropout. What happened in between those times was that I met a man who told me I was beautiful and promised that he could start my modeling career. He gave me his business card. He had on a three-piece suit, a charming smile, really nice young ladies with him who were his other models. And I took his card and decided to give him a phone call. The very next weekend, he set up my first professional photo shoot. 2 weeks after that, he got me a paid modeling gig. And right there on the set of the modeling gig, he asked me to fill out a W-9. Having worked at the Y before and a few other organizations, I knew what that was, a simple tax form that your employer needs in order to cut you a check. And so I filled out the form with my full name, my permanent address, which is my parents' home address here in Pasadena, my current address where I was living with my roommate in Atlanta near campus, my social security number, and a slew of other information. And I handed the modeling agent this W-9, assuming he would hand it to the director, and I'd receive a check in the mail. Didn't even think twice about it. By the fifth week of knowing this modeling agent, I saw a different side. We were headed to an industry party, and another one of his models, Michelle, was driving. Mike, the modeling agent, was in the front seat, and I was in the back seat. And a song came on the radio. And Mike said, "Hey, I like this. Who sings this?" And for whatever reason, Michelle didn't respond. I don't know if the music was too loud or she was just zoned out, but she didn't respond. And so casually, from the back seat, I said, "Oh, it's Maxwell. It's called Lifetime." Mike got so enraged, he reached over and he slapped Michelle so hard that her head hit the window, and she just started apologizing. "Mike, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry." And he was yelling at the top of his lungs, cursing at her, "Don't you ever ignore me, I know you heard me." And calling her every name, and she didn't look surprised, she just looked very scared and apologetic. And so in the back seat, never having seen abuse before, not understanding fully what was in front of my eyes, I assumed that this was a domestic dispute and that those scary Lifetime movies were real. And that must be his girlfriend and she needs to break up with him because he's one of those abusers and I better get away from the whole situation. And so the very next day, in my sweetest voice, I called Mike and I said, "You know, finals are coming up in school and it's getting really hard for me to balance school and modeling, and I appreciate all you've done for me so far, but I'm just gonna, you know, focus back on school, and I'll give you a call in the future if I ever wanna work with you again." And he was silent for a moment, and then the next words out of his mouth were, "Bitch, I own you. You're gonna do what I tell you to do, or somebody's gonna get hurt." And then he read off my parents' home address. And that was when I realized that the tax form I had given him to receive payment, he kept. He told me when and where to meet him that night, and he said if I didn't come to him, he would come to me. And then he read off my address. And so, in that moment, a million things were running through my head. Human trafficking was not one of them. I had no idea what it was, never heard of it. Thought that a pimp was somebody that looked like Snoop Dogg with a velvet suit on and a Jerry curl. And so at that point I thought, you know, Let me just stay on his good side. So I met him that night, went in where he said, assuming he wanted to talk or to win me over or I don't know what. But he had a buyer lined up, and that was the first night that I was forced into human trafficking. Just 5 short weeks after meeting a guy at a popular college hangout who promised me a modeling career. So, 5 months into the experience, I had succumbed to the mental manipulation. Federally, the definition of sex trafficking is causing someone to engage in commercial sexual exploitation by use of force, fraud, or coercion. In those first 5 weeks, I had succumbed to the force and the fraud. Intimidation, threats, physical violence, fraudulent modeling scheme. But 5 months later is when the coercion had set in, when I believed that I was a worthless piece of damaged goods, that there was no hope for redemption and no hope for escape. Another 5 months after that point, so now almost a year into this hell of human trafficking, I got a call from the Atlanta Police Department. Another one of my ex-victims found the courage to go to the police in the face of threats and danger and violence, and she gave them my name and number because I had become a forced recruiter at that time. So I was the one that had brought her in. And so when she went to the police, she gave them my name and number and mine. And so when they called me, it was as an accomplice to a trafficker. And they told me that I could either come into the station and tell my side of the story, or that they would put a warrant out for my arrest. So when I went into the station, I was reluctant to cooperate because that was the number one threat, that if we go to the police or if we go for help, he would kill us, kill our parents. But eventually I cooperated, and in order to avoid charges, I had to fully cooperate, which meant do undercover work to help their investigation. And so after some undercover work, it got too dangerous for me to stay in Atlanta. And so I had to go to the only place that I could go, which was home. And so having been raised here in sunny Southern California, I went to Atlanta, Georgia for college, and I'm still a daddy's girl, still very close to my parents, but they really had no idea what was going on for me for the past year. I spoke to them 2 or 3 times a week, but I only answered their phone call or called them when I was in a mood when I could act happy and make up some fun thing that I had been doing, so they had no idea. I had enrolled in school again, even though I had dropped out because I didn't want them to be alerted, so they were still paying tuition. But I hadn't attended classes in weeks. And so now, 2 weeks into what was supposed to be my senior year at Emory University, I called home and I said, Mom, Dad, can you guys pick me up tonight at LAX? And my mom is a total drama queen. First thing she said was, girl, you better not be pregnant. They demanded to know, why are you coming home? You're a senior, you're almost done with school. And I said, I'll explain when I get there. Can you please just pick me up? And so they met me that night at LAX, and it was a long, silent, awkward ride home. And when we got to the house, we sat around the kitchen table, and my dad broke the silence. He said, Rachel, you gotta tell us something. What's going on? Why aren't you in school right now? What's happening? And so I began to tell him a story of how I met a man who said he was a modeling agent, and I gave him too much information, and I did a lot of horrible, stupid things, and he became violent, and he became abusive, and he threatened all these things, and he has their home address, and I just laid out not even everything, but a lot of the hell I had gotten myself into. And I saw their shoulders slump, and I saw the tears well up in my father's eyes, and I knew that I had broken their hearts, and that I had ruined my life. And so I just acted that I was really tired, and I said, you know, I just want to go to bed tonight. It's been a long day. I just want to lay down. And so they excused me. They didn't say anything. And that night, on my bed in my room, I got out my notebook and wrote out a suicide letter. And my plan was to take my life, not only because I had already ruined it, but also to keep my parents safe, to avoid them the shame and embarrassment of telling their friends and my mom's partners at her law firm and all the social clubs they were a part of what their daughter had become. And so my plan was to go somewhere the next day and take my life. I didn't want them to find my body. But thank God I'm not a morning person. The next day they woke me up before I could get up, and they just asked me to come have breakfast with them. They had cooked breakfast, and so again we were around the kitchen table, and it was a quiet, awkward time again. But then my dad said, "Rachel, will you just stand up?" And so I stood up, and he just came and put his arms around me. And he said, "Rachel, we don't know what you've done. We don't know what you've been through. But we know that there is nothing so bad that you could ever do that we don't still love you and that God doesn't still love you." And he just put his arms around me and held me. And then my mom came and joined in the hug. And I don't know if it was 30 seconds, 30 minutes, 30 hours, but it was exactly what I needed in that moment. A reassurance of love, of hope for restoration. That was what I needed to continue to have the will to live. I didn't see myself getting back on track. I didn't see a happy, bright future, but I knew that somebody else saw something in me enough that I could at least live another day. So after that point, there was a long road to recovery, and essentially what I did was swept this whole experience under the rug and eventually got back into school, eventually got my master's in education from UCLA, and became a teacher, which is what I had planned to do all along. I've always wanted to be a teacher since I was a little girl. And so I started out teaching high school English. And then I moved into corporate training, corporate America. And I did this for about 9 years. And I kept switching jobs because something was missing. I felt something was missing. Didn't tell anyone my story. Didn't want to know anything about the field or the subject. Literally wanted to act like it never happened. Didn't seek therapy for it. Just got really involved in the church and focused on being a happy, good, whole person, but not addressing that part of my history. And so it took another tragedy to catapult me into where God wanted me to be. One of my favorite students, a ninth grader, sweet, innocent, beautiful, amazing young woman. She and I got very close, and then she started ditching class and missing class a little bit, and was just changing the group of people she hung out with, changing how she dressed. And when I spoke with her more in depth, she told me that her boyfriend and her were making plans to move to Las Vegas. And when I asked how old her boyfriend was, he was 32. And so as she's speaking to me, I'm seeing a lot of my own past come up. Older guy preying on a younger girl. And some of the things that he was telling her and the ideals that he was planting into her head and just her changes and personality, I realized that she was being preyed upon by a pimp. And my plan was to go to her house, sit her down with her guardians. She was in the foster care system, so she didn't have mother and father, but she had people who cared for her. And I was going to tell her my story, and that would be the first time in 9 years that I had told anyone, except for the prosecutors during trial. The night I was supposed to go over there, she didn't come home. She never came home again. Never had the opportunity to intervene. Never heard from her again. That experience is what led me to start Sowers Education Group. In 2012, my husband heard my story. I had told him small bits and pieces, but I laid it out to him for the first time. And the purpose was I wanted to convince him that I couldn't stay silent anymore. This has been the missing thing. This is why I keep switching jobs. This is what that missing purpose and passion is. So we started Sowers Education Group, and we named it Sowers Education Group for two Bible verses. One, God gives seed to the sower. If you think about it, that's like saying God gives tools to the builder. And it's like, well, how will I build without tools? How do I step into this role without having the resources? But really that means you take the first steps and God will meet you there. Work with what you have now, do what's on your heart to do, and the resources will come. And the other reason we named it Sowers Education Group is because as I learned more about the tragedy of human trafficking, the devastating, insidious, global, massive crime against humanity being perpetrated, I got discouraged for a while, thinking, I'm just one person with one bad, sad story. What can I really do? Am I gonna leave my corporate job? Am I gonna leave my salary? Am I gonna leave my reputation? Am I gonna leave all these comforts that I've established for myself at this point and step into this whole other realm and share this part of me that nobody knows? So the Bible verse talks about sowing seeds and the different types of ground the seed can fall on. Some of the seed may fall on hard ground and not grow. Some of the seed may fall among the rocks or the weeds or the thorns and grow for a little bit and then stop growing. But some seeds will fall on good soil and will sprout and will produce a fruit and a harvest. And so that verse reminds me that I do my part. I sow seeds and trust that even if I don't see the impact that my one voice is having, it's having an impact. Saving a life, changing a mindset. So today, having been in business, in ministry for 5 years, it is absolutely amazing what God has done. Absolutely amazing. Pablo Picasso said, "The purpose of life is to find your gift. The meaning of life is to give it away." My message to you is to follow the gifts, the passions that are on your heart. If it was born out of trauma, if it was born out of tragedy, if it was born out of something that you were trying to forget, if that's what's on your heart and you feel that that's where you're being called, pursue that. Today, I am living a life that I love. I wouldn't trade with anyone else. Just starting literally in my teacher friends' classrooms, talking to their young ladies and boys about human trafficking. From there, it went to come speak to my church, and then can you train our social workers? Can you train law enforcement? Today, we've spoken to over 50,000 live audience members, millions more through media, been featured on TD Jake's show. CNN is doing a special about our curriculum, Ending the Game, which is reaching 200 survivors annually. That'll be coming out in July. And all of these amazing opportunities and doors that are opening is because I believe I'm doing what God has called me to do.
Amen.
So my message to everyone out there is to follow your passion, follow your heart, make a living, and make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel, for your courage and bravery for telling your stories and sharing. We're going to do something a little different for Rachel because she has to leave because today is her son's 1-year-old birthday. Oh. So she'll be leaving at 2. And so something different is we're going to take the Q&A now instead of on a panel. So are there any questions for Rachel?
Rachel, thanks for sharing the amazing story. So you seem to have a very good relationship with your parents, and I just kind of wanted to ask you, what was it that kept you from, you know, communicating them earlier with what you were going through and asking them for help?
Good question. Two things. Two different fears. The first were the fears of retaliation from the trafficker. There's oftentimes a grooming phase, and he knew that my parents meant a lot to me. So that was a threat he reiterated. If I go for help, if I tell them, if I tell anyone, that he would kill them. He had their home address memorized. And so anytime I hesitated in obedience, he would begin to recite their address. And so it really felt like I was protecting them by keeping the secret to myself. And the other fear, and this is what I tell parents whenever I have the opportunity to speak to parent groups, is fear that their love was conditional. Because up until then, I had been a good child. They were wonderful parents. Upper middle class home in Pasadena, went to, you know, great schools, voted prom queen, got into the top 20 university, 4.0 GPA. And so I knew that they loved me, but I also knew or thought that it was because I had done everything right. And I didn't know that their love was unconditional. They didn't make that part clear. They were very proud of me. And a lot of times when, you know, they would express their love and pride in me, it was because of the things I had done. And so what I tell parents, you know, for your children, do a puzzle, take out one puzzle piece, and impress upon them that your love for them, your life, would be incomplete without them in it. Your love is not conditional. It's not based on what you've done. It's not based on what you've accomplished. If you have anything that you have to share with us, whether it's going to disappoint us or break our hearts, we will not love you any less. And that was the message that kept me from sharing this part with them also, fear that they would stop loving me.
That was an amazing story. Thank you for sharing. So as a father of two girls, what advice or how do you, when you talk to the girls in school, what advice do you give to them to teach them how to prevent something like this from happening to themselves?
Well, you know, trafficking is a global issue. And in our country, it looks different than it does in India or Cambodia. Because it can't be as blatant and above ground, right? So traffickers here have strategies. And so if you familiarize yourself with different trafficker strategies, there are different types of traffickers. The Romeo pimp will present himself as a boyfriend, and there's a months-long grooming process of gifts and compliments and that romantic phase. I have a handout just front and back, very simple, that is downloadable for free on the website, sowerseducationgroup.com. And it just talks about different trafficker strategies, red flags to look out for, different phrases that, you know, should cause some concern that this person does not have your best interest in mind. And then for the CEO traffickers, the ones who present themselves as modeling agents or talent agents, there's a whole different strategy for that. And so just knowing the different types of strategies there are in our country for how people are lured in, because we don't see as much of just the, you know, the kidnapping, like in the movie Taken. there's usually a lure in our country. So knowing what those lures are and knowing how to stay safe, who to call. So I would encourage you to go to sowerseducationgroup.com, and under the educational resources, it's the first link, just a front and back paper about what human trafficking is, what it looks like in our country, and how traffickers are preying on our youth.
Yes, my question would be, what advice would you give survivors who are also looking to put their story with entrepreneurship? I know that's a big, broad question, but just any advice that you would give to survivors who want to make, you know, their social justice cause their story, but they want to mix it with entrepreneurship, or what do you feel like some of the biggest challenges are to, or hurdles to get over?
Man, you know, that is huge. And for usually when I speak, especially on college campuses, or even in churches, most venues, someone will come up to me afterwards and say that they are a survivor and haven't told anyone, and they want to start doing, you know, something to combat trafficking. And everyone's path is different. For me, since I had already in me this passion and gift for education, and then I pursued the master's in it, so it was an easy marriage for me to then use my skills and talents towards this movement. But for others, you know, whether it's the arts, becoming a social worker, to protect, you know, vulnerable children, I mean, there are so many ways other than, you know, sharing your story on a mic that survivors can have a huge impact in this movement. And so I really encourage people, just whatever those passions and talents are, use it for good, you know? But that is a longer answer, and we're gonna connect after.
I don't know if I need your mic.
Thanks. My question, and thank you for sharing, I mean, what a huge issue. I've dealt with some of it internationally. And the question that I have is, when you think about what you're trying to do and what you're trying to build, and of course, the evidence of even people coming up and talking about, you know, being survivors, do you have a team? When you think about building out and the great need that's out there and getting into the churches and getting the messages out to fathers and mothers and on and on, the thing that you're building besides Sowards Education Group, do you have a team that's allowing you to get that message out faster and further, or is it you and your husband?
Good question. So that was another part of the vision that God put on my heart. We named it Sowards Education Group, and it was just two of us, you know, but that was one of the things. It's like, no, you know, we're going to sow seeds, we're going to eventually have a group, and we do today. We have a group of survivor leaders who have created the curriculum with us, who, if I'm not available to speak or if they want someone from a different demographic, we have, as of right now, there are 9 other survivors that we try to, you know, give employment opportunities with speaking. So we're formulating the group. We always are taking in more to our family for the same mission and partnering with others. You know, you don't have to be part of our group, just other people that are doing good work, just collaborating and knowing more of the good guys.
One other question. Knowing we have limited time, limited resources, do you have a target market? Do you have a target audience, like the church or the school? Or, I mean, do you have a target that you're focused on primarily?
Yes, we do. In fact, our focus has changed because the good thing, since we started in 2012, human trafficking was not in the media. Right? People really didn't think it happened here. A lot of that awareness work has been done, not done to. So our focus has shifted to now survivor empowerment. We have the first intervention curriculum for survivors of sex trafficking. And it's really targeting that coercion piece, the psychological manipulation that so many survivors have been subjected to. And that's the hardest hurdle to overcome when regaining your true self, when leaving that lifestyle, leaving that subculture. So our target is now organizations that work directly with survivors, running groups, offering housing, offering counseling. So that usually is residential treatment facilities, group homes, juvenile detention centers, drop-in centers, people that are working directly with survivors or victims.
I just want to thank you, Rachel, for having the courage to share your story. You know, the cost of kind of giving that away, like sharing that, so I just want to thank you very much. And my question is especially about the, I don't know how you call it like that, the whole psychological
coercion.
You know, coercion and ritual abuse, like that whole piece, like how did you come to a place where you kind of saw, okay, this is real? And were there things that even in your own close circles, people that didn't want you to share your story, and how did you overcome that?
Well, the piece about the psychological coercion, that was something that I pursued wholeheartedly because I knew that until I understood that, I wouldn't be able to move forward with my life. I didn't understand how in less than 1 year, I was flipped so dramatically. You know, my confidence was gone, my hope for the future was gone, everything had been stripped. And so when I found myself in witness protection, isolated in an apartment for 6 months, with no interaction, no nothing to do but to sit and think, that was what I started journaling about. The only time I left my witness protection room was to go to the Rock Church in San Diego, and on Tuesday night was youth night. And I mean, so that was when I started to understand and read books about cults and see that traffickers are essentially cult leaders, and they are indoctrinating people with a whole different set of rules, a whole another identity, using a lot of the same techniques as cult leaders, you know, positive and negative reinforcement, giving you a new name, a new purpose, a new identity. I mean, it's very involved. And the more I talk to other victims who would say, you know, I'm out, but I still feel like I want to go back sometimes. Or I'm out and I really don't believe that I can make any money or have make a living without selling my body, have it become part of their spirit. You know, I really don't think I'm good enough to date anyone. I really think I'm damaged this. And really just how the chain around the brain was still there, even if their bodies were free. And so that was what led me to understand that in the psychology of being enslaved, and how once you're no longer a slave, if you still have a slave mentality, you're still not free. So I think that was part one of your question. And then what was the next part?
Were there people around you that didn't want you to share? I think just because I've experienced it, but more like, it's internal, you know? So there's more barriers to sharing what's going on. So
yeah.
Did you have anyone that was like,
oh, sure,
do this?
Yeah, just, I mean, that was a lot of the fear that kept me silent for all those years. And my husband is wonderful, and he was supportive, and he still is supportive, but I remember the first time that I was interviewed on the news, and we put it on Facebook, and people watched and actually heard my story. Four of his friends reached out to him and were like, you married her? You know, an ex-prostitute? And so I had my own family members who would come to hear me speak, and I would see them in the room, and then they wouldn't say anything afterwards. You know, so it's like, okay, well, now you know my story, but nothing after that, you know? And then you're just left to wonder, what are you thinking? Because there was no words after. And so there's always that fear of being vulnerable publicly and letting people, you know about your darkest moments. And so I think that goes back to the sowers and seeds analogy, where maybe it's not for everyone then, but I'm gonna keep doing what's on my heart to do and what I'm being led to do.
Anyone else?
If in after hearing you and in our lives we come across somebody personally through happenstance, maybe we recognize something, or at my more mature age, start to suspect something may be going on, whether it's a friend or a family member or someone in the community. Is this a function that the police department, what would we do? Would we call the police? I mean, is there a special units, or what is the action?
Yeah, so the National Human Trafficking Hotline number would be the go-to, no matter where you are in the country. And that number is 888-3737-888, and you could write it somewhere. 888-3737-888, and they will take any leads that you have. If something just doesn't feel right, if you want to make a report that, you know, you saw a young girl or boy that looked like they were maybe a little bit fearful, whatever you have to report, they'll take that, and if it's a strong enough lead, then they'll contact the local law enforcement and follow through.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. We'll publicize that later, that number. Anyone else?
Yeah, first, just want to thank you so much for your story and just for emphasizing the faith element. That has been something that over our work has just been such a prominent piece of it, just understanding that the Spirit of God in Christ is such a vital just element of that road to recovery. One of the frustrations we've had a lot is being a media organization that works with survivors and people who've been through trauma. I know you shared that it took you quite a while to open up and share your story, and that it took obviously a very painful experience for that to happen. One thing that we always come up against and is largely frustrating for me and our team is when we see somebody who hasn't taken that step of sharing that story and we can see that they're still running in some way, they built the life structure, you know, they're out of the traumatizing situation, or at least not as immersed as they were, but they still have not come into that place of honesty, like, I need to share it. So my question would be, is there any, I'm sure there's not just one thing, but could you shed any light on perhaps an environment we can create, a way that we can foster maybe that stepping into that place, because we believe that to be a pinnacle element of how they're going to recover. So how do you help someone step into that realm of finally being able to talk about it, share about it, and step into that place of recovery?
I'm not sure it's a necessary step in anybody's recovery to share it with others, because it's so personal, you know, that I think there can be true and full healing without that aspect there. But if they haven't acknowledged it to themselves, dealt with it themselves, I mean, I would love to say therapy, but unless the therapist is like an OG and really knows about, you know, some deep stuff, I've seen where therapy is, you know, where the therapist is crying more than the client, and it's like, okay, you know, learn about human trafficking, and then come, you know, because it's devastating, and it's not something that every therapist is equipped to handle. The Ending the Game curriculum does a lot, and I think one of the biggest healing components for me was connecting with survivor sisters and brothers, sharing with people that have been through what you've been through, that you can gain strength from, that can become your role models, become someone that's not gonna judge you and that kind of gets it more than the other people in your life. So just really connecting them to that community of other people who've been through what they've been through and are thriving and can give a picture of what their future can look like.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rachel. And thank you for coming today and sharing your brave and courageous story. Let's give a warm